Good day, and thank you for joining us for Sabbath church service here at the Anaheim Seventh-day Adventist Church. I want to welcome members of both the Orange and Anaheim SDA churches as we have combined for these weekly services. We are so sorry to not be meeting in person, but you certainly understand that we have to be extra careful during these times. We miss you, and we are holding you up in prayer, and we would like to be hearing from you if there's anything that we can do to serve you. We, of course, are praying for your health and your well-being. That means health on the physical aspect, the mental aspect, the emotional aspect, and of course the spiritual aspect. Please do not hesitate to reach out to Pastor Nathaniel or myself if there's anything that we can do for you. Say a prayer for you, open the Word together, maybe a doorfront visit from somewhat of a distance, a brief visit. We're more than happy to reach out to you. Don't forget that both churches have food available, the Orange SDA Church via their food pantry. That food pantry is available during midweek afternoons, during office hour time. Or if those times aren't convenient, give a call or an email or a text. We will make sure to open up at a time that's convenient for you. Also here at the Anaheim SDA Church, we give away 60 to 80 boxes of food every Wednesday afternoon at 5 p.m. Lately, those lines have been getting long and the food runs out within 30 to 45 minutes. So we want to encourage you to come and receive if you are in need, but do try to come as close to 5 p.m. as possible on Wednesdays. A few other announcements for each church. First of all, here at the Anaheim Church, for a few weeks now, we have been having our Sabbath School program on the courtyard. We discuss the Sabbath School lesson. We have a short song service and also a mini sermonette, if you will. We want to thank our participants who are helping that to work out each week. We're also excited because next week we will be having a baptism of a young couple. They've been studying for several weeks with one of our elders here at the Anaheim SDA Church. We will be attaching that to our church service video, I believe, 2 weeks from today. Orange SDA Church has several exciting announcements. First of all, there is Sabbath School this afternoon, Kids Sabbath School, at 1:30 p.m. here on this same YouTube channel. If you're watching this on Sabbath morning, the morning that it posts, it's this afternoon at 1:30. Of course, if you're watching it later in the week, the video should already be there from what was already recorded. Also, next week, August 8th, will be the first time that the Orange SDA Church is having their adult Sabbath School discussion on the grass, kind of between the parking lot and the church. There will be some shade available, but we want to request people to bring their own chairs, their own mask, and their own water bottle. We'll have a lovely discussion time out there. Pastor Nathaniel is going to be there, and we just pray that that'll be a blessing for everybody. Also next week, August 8th, we're going to have a special young adult church service. So we want to thank in advance those young people who are going to be helping fill our service and make it a joyful time. We pray that this service today will be a blessing. I pray that it gives us a sense of unity and, of course, affirmation of the Lord and His goodness. What a blessing, especially during trying times, that we can put away our stresses, our personal worries, and simply worship God who is enthroned on high. He has promised to bring us through this. He has promised to take us to heaven, to make everything new, and we rejoice in those promises in anticipation. Praise the Lord for a Sabbath day in which we rest in the completeness of His salvation. We pray that you and your families are blessed today, and again, do not hesitate to reach out if there's anything we can do to serve you personally. God bless you all.
Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath. Our opening hymn will be number 516, All the Way, singing all three stanzas, so please join us.
Thank you. the little ones and bring them close to the computer, and we have a story for them. So today's story is about Joseph. You might have heard of him before. He is the great-grandson of Abraham, who walked very closely with God and was promised that his descendants, his children, would make a great nation and eventually the nation of God. Joseph is his great-grandson, and Joseph was the second youngest of his family. He had lots of older brothers. And also, Joseph was kind of the favorite child. His parents spoiled him just a little bit. He was taught how to read and write while his brothers were out in the field working. And he was also given a very special gift called the coats of many colors. Now this here is a scarf, but it might have looked similar to this to some extent, where it had all these pretty colors. And back then, all the clothing was handmade, and so you'd have to dye the cloth to make it different colors. So having this was not easy and took a lot of work to make. But Joseph got this fancy coat full of all these pretty colors, and his brothers became very jealous and angry that he got such a special gift. Can you guys make an angry face? Make your best angry face. There you go. So his brothers were angry because they were jealous that Joseph got his own coats. And because of their anger, they went out and they started to plot against Joseph. So one day while they were out in the field, Joseph goes out to them to bring them some food, and they attack him. They grab his coat, they rip it off, and then they toss him in a pit. And eventually, they sell him to some slave traders. Now, slaves are people that work without getting paid. Now, a lot of times, they're not treated the nicest either. Slaves are not people. God does not want us to treat people the way that slaves are treated, because we are all should respect each other because we're all children of God. But so while Joseph was sold to slavery, he worked up the ranks and he went through some hard times, but he became the head of one of the people's houses, and then he was tossed in jail for something he didn't do. And then while he was in jail, he interpreted some dreams for some people, and then word got to the king. When the king was having some bad nightmares, Joseph was there and was able to interpret the dreams. So this is a crown. Kings wear crowns typically. So the king had a bad dream, and Joseph came and he said, there is going to be some bad weather. There's going to be a great famine, and there won't be enough food for everybody. And so the king put Joseph in charge, basically made him like a prince, and he was able to put a system forward to save a lot of the food in order to have it during the famine. And so then one day his brothers come to Egypt and they are hungry. There's no food left in the land and they need food. And they heard Egypt has food. And they come in and lo and behold, they see Joseph and he is there. And in that moment, Joseph was able to forgive his brothers and give them some food. And so even though Joseph went through some times that were kind of difficult, they were a little unfair and they were not the most ideal situations, God was still there through it all and was able to use Joseph to save a lot of people in the process. Joseph, in his response to his brothers, says this. So, do not fear. I will provide for you and your little ones. Thus he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. This is the kind of love that we can only learn from God. The love that says, even though you've hurt me and you've done me wrong, I am going to comfort you and I'm going to love you and take care of you. And so this week, remember that God is good all the time. And even when things are a little unfair, and to know that God is always good and God always loves you. And it'll be okay in the end.
Let's bow our heads and prepare our hearts to pray.
Our Father in heaven, we're once again grateful for all that you have done for us. Be with us and guide us through these uncertain times. Be with our church leaders. Give them the fortitude and leadership. Be with our general conference. Be with our family members and those who are hurting. Take control of this coronavirus, that those who have been affected by it, give them comfort and strength. We ask for forgiveness of our sins as we go through these days and these times. Strengthen our witness for those who are just waiting to hear and listen and to cling on to thy word. These are the blessings we ask in your namesake. Amen.
Today's scripture is coming to us from Isaiah chapter 9, verses 1 and 2. But there shall be no gloom to her that was in anguish. In the former time he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time hath he made it glorious by the way of the sea, beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people that walked in the darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, unto them hath the light shined.
Do you like game shows? There was a game show that was around a couple years ago that was huge, and I loved it and watched it often. You might have heard of it. It was called The Weakest Link. The show originally came out in the year 2000 in the UK. Essentially, the game consisted of 9 contestants all playing on the same team, and with each question that was answered correctly, they would get a certain dollar amount per question. And as each person answered the questions correctly and correctly, the money would grow and grow until they either got the question wrong and they lost everything, or they could simply say one word, and the word is bank, and all that money would go into a bank and they would start over at zero. Well, as this game would continue round after round, at the end of each round, they would have to vote off who they thought was the weakest link. Either they got the questions correctly, or they called bank and put the money away, and then they had to start at zero, and the group didn't like that, and they would vote that person off as considered the weakest link. Well, at other times, these teams got a little more competitive, and it wasn't always the weakest person who was voted off. In fact, sometimes it was the strongest link who was voted off, because they knew they couldn't compete with that person, and they wanted the winnings for themselves, because at the very end of the game, only one person could walk away with the grand prize of all the money. You know, it's very interesting the way we see this game, because if we look at the world around us, this is the world that we live in. Everyone is constantly looking for the weakest link. We're looking for things of how to get better. We're looking at things of how can we upgrade. We're looking at ways of how to get rid of even things that may we feel are holding us back, and in some cases, how to eliminate people from our lives that we feel may be holding us back from what we want. The weakest link. You know, it's interesting, there's a scriptural text of scripture in the Bible that God actually talks to us about. He does things very differently from our perspective. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 27, it says this of God's countercultural ways of dealing with us and dealing in this world. In verse 27, it says, "But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are." You see, the things that we think in this world are very strong, God could rid them with just the thoughts. God could easily bring them down. If you just look around the nation around us, something so small like a virus has had huge implications, has had huge destruction inside of our entire nation and even the world. Now, that is not to minimize the seriousness of this. This is not to minimize the severity of death, it is called. All those who have been infected by it, the hundreds of thousands who have died from this, and even the millions who have been infected, and even those of us who are suffering around the world because of it. Not in the least. What this is saying is we were not prepared for this. We didn't think that this could penetrate the walls of our country. We didn't think that this would be something that could bring us down. We were not prepared. In some senses, this was our weakest link. We thought it could never happen. Well, what does the Bible have to say about weak links? I'd like to turn to Isaiah chapter 9. Isaiah chapter 9, but to give you a little background of what's going on in the scriptures at this point, we see that at this time the United Kingdom of Israel had already split up. It was no longer at its golden age of Saul and David and Solomon. In fact, it was split into two groups, the southern and northern kingdom, and they were actually tagging with foreign pagan kings to attack the other. The northern kingdom of Israel was collaborating with the pagan kings and attacking the south, and the south was collaborating with kings to defend itself against the north, and they kept on going back and forth looking for the weaknesses in the other group, looking to attack their own people while collaborating with foreign nations. They were looking for the weakest link in how to defeat each other. When the reality is, Isaiah says, let's not look for the weakest link, let's look for the missing link. What's the missing link and why all of these things are happening? You know, as these battles continue to evolve between God's people, they begin to fall to other nations. You see, they were united, but as they were united, they began to fight amongst each other, and then they lost their unity. They lost the blessing that God had given them. They began to be pulled away, and then the groups began to come inside and destroy them. The Syrian king Tilgath-Pileser came in and he made them slaves, and he infected the land with his idols. But even before that, King Benhadad of Assyria, just 200 years before, also did the same. And paganism was rampant all over the land. You see, Israel had left God so long ago, and now they were filled with all different sorts of paganism and religions instead of the worship to God. And it is in this context that Isaiah gives these words in verse 1 through 3 of chapter 9. And he says this, "But there will be no gloom for those who were in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he will make glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee, and of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them the light has shone." What a beautiful, beautiful passage here to remind us of what God is constantly doing. You see, the world that we live in right now, we see doctors going against doctors. We see politicians going against politicians. We even see Christians going against Christians, and we're exposing each other and pushing each other, and we're not looking at the missing link, which is Jesus. We're not looking at what God is trying to do inside of our own individual lives, let alone the society around us. We're constantly looking for the weakest link, and it's destroying us, and it's pushing us further and further apart. I want to point out something in this text that is profound to us. It says, a light came out of darkness. Let me ask you, can light come out of darkness? No, light cannot come out of darkness. Something has to be put in there to have a light come out of darkness. Something miraculous has to happen. Something has to be placed there. Someone or something has to put it there to bring a light out. And you know where this is going. It is God who puts the light in places. It is God's presence that brings warmth, that exposes the lies, that makes truth beautiful, that brings unity together. It is Christ. It is the Son of the living God who makes all of this possible. You see, church, it's not about the weakest link. It's the missing link that will take us from gloom to glory. It's not just positive thinking. It's not just staying away from the things that we think might bring us down. It's not even negative thinking, because all of that is just built upon ourselves. It is looking heavenward. It is looking at who Jesus is. It is looking at where God is leading and what He is doing in our lives and in the world around us. James chapter 1:17 has these beautiful words. It says, "Every generous act of giving with every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there's no variation or shadow due to change." We need to stop looking at the things that are going around us and try and take ownership like it's our responsibility to change this negativity that's going around, or try to push in this positivity. We need to focus on Jesus. We need to focus on the light of the world. We need to focus on He who brings lights out of darkness and exposes the lies, exposes the things that are happening in this world. Because, church, there's nothing you or I can do to change the propaganda for or against of anything or anyone. We have to look heavenward, and we have to focus on Jesus, because every generous gift, every perfect gift, everything comes down from the Father of lights. When we focus more on our abilities or our inabilities and not who God is, we miss what God is doing. We miss the precepts which He has put in front of us to live by. We miss how God is even preparing us on what He's trying to do through us during this time. It's not just when we get out of this, it's what He's doing in us and through us while we're in this moment, while we're in this time. Are we looking heavenward? Are we allowing Him to take us to glory out of this gloom? Are we looking at the missing link and not the weakest link? Notice what happens when we begin to allow God to take us out of the mess that we sometimes put ourselves in. Notice in Isaiah chapter 9, the next verse, in verse 4 and 5, it says this: "For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor you have broken, is on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the trampling warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire." You see, many times God has to get us out of our burdens that we sometimes have placed ourselves in. He has to break the oppression that we have put ourselves in. He has to break the bonds that hold us down, that hold us away from Him. And I like to elaborate a little bit on this reference of Midian. You see, this reference of Midian, this whole story is actually referring back to the time of Gideon, when Gideon was a nobody, when Gideon was not sure of what he should do in the world. And right now God was calling out to him, and Gideon said, "Who am I?" Mind. He says, "I want you to help your people be free from the people of Midian." And so I wanted us to turn to Judges chapter 7 briefly. Judges chapter 7, and it's the amazing battle of Gideon against the Midianites. And it's important to keep in mind, when following God, in the midst of focusing on our abilities, to just stop doing that and to focus on what God has asked us to do and what He's asking us to do. What pulls us away from God towards our own abilities in the first place? And I believe this text answers that. Judges chapter 7, beginning in verse 2, and it says this: "The Lord said to Gideon, 'The troops with you are too many for me to give them into your hand. Israel would only take credit away from me, saying, "My hand has delivered me." Now, therefore, proclaim this to the hearing of the troops: whoever is fearful and trembling, let him return home.' Thus Gideon sifted them out. 22,000 returned, and 10,000 remained. Notice what God says. I don't want you to rely on yourselves. That's the first thing he said. I don't want you to think you did this. I don't want you to think you got yourselves out. I don't want you to take the credit or even it enter into your mind that you had anything to do with this. How did he do this? He said, you care about the numbers. Do we have enough horses? Do we have enough troops? Do we have enough archers? Do we have enough to combat against the enemy? And he says, I don't want those numbers to enter your mind to determine your victory. God says, it's not you who fight your battle, but it is me. I fight the battle. I fight the battle. And church, many times, even during this quarantine, we look at the numbers, and many of us, as these people, are fearful, and rightfully so. Notice what it says. They're concerned, and we're concerned, and rightfully so. We can't hold worship the way we usually do, and guess what? Rightfully so. But that shouldn't stop us from following God and what He's called us to do. How can we hear the voice of God in the day and age we live today and follow what He's calling us to do? Well, it's very simple. We have to do it in a different way, church. But are we fearful to allow God to lead us to do it in a different way? What way is He calling us to do it? Because from the beginning we see here, God is saying, you have 22,000. You have too much. I'm going to leave you with less than half. Because I know you're afraid. If you're afraid, stay home. If you're trembling, go back home. Because this battle is a serious battle, and it's not built on your ability, but it's based on what God's going to do. What was the second concern? We won't read it. We'll just go through it. But God basically told them, for those who lick the water when they're thirsty versus those who lap it and shove their face and just drinking and drinking, send those people home. And the application is very simple for us, church. Are there things that you thirst more than for God? Are there things that you're doing in your life right now that are more important to you than serving God or what God has called you to do? Because if that's so, God might be sifting that too. God's asking you the question, is there something that you thirst for more than serving me? Because if that's the case, that might be something where you've sifted yourself out. See, God is wanting to win this battle, but wants us to rely on Him. Not on our abilities, our inabilities. God wants to use us, but He wants us to trust Him. On His plans, on His preparing, on ways that He works. You see, when we focus on Jesus and not on our abilities or inabilities, He brings light out of darkness. He brings Himself into the picture. He plants the seed and it grows. He brings the light and it shines. And the verse continues in this beautiful, beautiful prophetic passage of Jesus in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. And it says this, "For a child has been born for us. A son is given to us, authority rests upon His shoulders, and He is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." A beautiful prophecy is given in a time of gloom, and God's saying, I'm going to take you from gloom to glory, but it's based on the shoulders of my Son and not on your abilities, not on your inabilities, not even what things that are going around outside of you. It's based on keeping your eyes heavenward and allowing me to prepare you even during this time and continually follow me despite what is going on. You know that gloom that was lingering in Naphtali? You know that gloom that was with Zebulun? Because those cities, those tribes were on the northern edges of the kingdom. They were constantly in warfare. They were constantly being mixed with other nations, with other idols, and there was just a certain darkness around them. And the other tribes saw it and they felt it. And in some ways they were even outcast. That's why it was called this darkness that was there. And Isaiah had to speak to them and say, God is going to do something. A light will come. And in Matthew chapter 4, we read this beautiful promise, that's this prophecy that was fulfilled as Jesus came to this earth. This is what happens when you focus more on Jesus than our abilities. And notice what it says. Right after Jesus was tempted, He came out of the wilderness. Isaiah's prophecy is not explained through Gideon, but fulfilled in the person of Jesus. In Matthew chapter 4, verse 13. We read this passage in Matthew chapter 4, verse 13 to 16. This was after Jesus was tempted in the wilderness. Isaiah's prophecy is not explained through Gideon, but it's explained and fulfilled in the person of Jesus. Matthew chapter 4, verse 13 says this: "He, Jesus, left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what was spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. The land of Zebulun, the land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea across the Jordan in Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned." Jesus himself ministered, grew, was placed in this place of darkness. And it was from this place that he ministered. And all the world, we see these miracles around this land. We see the preaching by the Galilee. We may even see the Sermon on the Mount. And all these things happen in the land where Jesus came and brought light where there was darkness. The ministry of Jesus, the person of Jesus came. But church, notice, it took some time. It took hundreds of years, and I know this coronavirus is not going to last hundreds of years, but it's going to take some time. But in the midst of it, God was preparing Naphtali, this land. He was preparing Zebulun, and I promise you, God is preparing us as a people, as a church, as Anaheim, as Orange, as a nation, as a world. God is preparing, and what are we doing to receive that? Are we acting in fear? Are we acting and trembling? Are we thirsty for something more than who Jesus is? Because our lives have now been changed or transformed. Because the things that we used to do, the things we used to be able to do, we feel unable to do. And the things we were unable to do, we feel even worse about being able to even try it. But God is calling us, church, to look heavenward, to look at Him, because He wants to bring the light out of darkness, and only Jesus can do that. February 11th, 2014, Shirley Temple, arguably the most famous child star in Hollywood, she died at the age of 85. February 11th, 2014. She was an inspiration during the Great Depression. She started acting at the age of 3. By 6, she did 20 movies, hit the box office records, and 4 years running. And at the age of 7, the president asked her to meet her and thanked her for the smiling face that helped people during this dark time of the Great Depression. They even named a drink after her, if you didn't know that. She transitioned from not only just being this movie star, but she became a diplomat in front of Congress, an ambassador for America to peace. She not only saved the movie industry, but helped bring communism down. Shirley went on to be United States representative in the United Nations, the U.S. ambassador to the Republic of Ghana, and the first woman to be the U.S. chief of protocol during the General Ford's administration, and the U.S. ambassador to Czechoslovakia. You see, it's not just us adults or older people who know what to do, but as Jesus was a child, who was this wonderful counselor and peace that Isaiah prophesied, there are children today who could even change the world, and God can use anyone. It doesn't matter what you don't have. It doesn't matter what you think you are unable to do. God can use you to be a light in dark places. Can take us from glory out of gloom. The smile of the face of Jesus as he walked down that road inside of Naphtali and Zebulun changed people's lives. But we have to be thirsty for more, church. We have to be thirsty for more. And we can't be fearful, and we have to stop looking at the weakest link. We have to look at the missing link. Where is Jesus wanting to bring light out of darkness? And when we allow God to do this, church, He will take us from glory out of gloom. From gloom to glory, church. This is my prayer for you, that we would allow Him to be our wonderful counselor, our mighty God, and in doing so, be our Prince of Peace. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Nathaniel, for that wonderful, inspiring message. Now it is time for our closing hymn, number 316, Live Out Thy Life Within Me, all four stanzas.
We hope you've been blessed by our worship service, church, and we want to thank all of our participants who've been involved in making this happen. And we ask that as you continue to move out throughout your day, that you continue to keep your eyes heavenward and keep on praying for your brothers and sisters who are hurting. We ask that you join us now as we have a word of prayer. Let us pray. Dear God, what a privilege it is to have you in our lives. What a privilege it is to even know that it is you who is the source of life, who gives us hope, who gives us meaning, who reminds us, God, that it is not about our abilities or inabilities, but it is about you. It is not about the weakest link, but the missing link. God, it seems as if we look at our land and it feels like you are missing from many places. But God, may that not be the case in our lives. May that not be the case in our homes. May that not be the case in our church where we worship you wholeheartedly. May we not be like the United Kingdom that became a split kingdom and disaster fell as a result. God, we pray that you would be the link in our lives that continually holds us together, that holds us strong, that keeps us worshiping you, that keeps us hopeful. God, I pray for those who may have lost their jobs. I pray, God, for those who are sick. I pray for those who are not sure of what they should do. And God, I pray for those of us who are searching of what you would have us do. God, my prayer is we would allow you to take us from the dark place and make us the light in those places. That you would inhabit our very being. That we would thirst for you beyond everything else. God, we thank you for being a mighty God. We thank you for being our Prince of Peace. And God, take us forward day by day, knowing that you know what the future holds. And we trust that you would bring us through. We ask for your blessing, not because we deserve it, but because you are a good God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I felt the need that I needed to go Brazil during the 2014 World Cup. We were told not to go into favelas at all. we ended up taking the risk of going into one at night the very first time, which was even, it's a bad idea. As pimps, traffickers, prostitutes, people that you would consider had absolutely no hope. But we would get there, we talked to them, and all of a sudden we realized God was already working in their lives. And I just wanted to do something. After I do a presentation or something, so what do I do? How do I intervene in human trafficking? What is the first step? And they look at me a little odd when I basically respond with, well, pray. Jesus is the intercessor, and that's what makes us safe. It's what makes us safe from the devil's accusations and attacks, and it's also what makes us children in the sight of God. I'm a steward because my Father is the giver.
For more than 60 years, Crawford Broadcasting has made a name for itself, being one of the country's biggest names in Christian media. Our broadcasts spread the word of God and bring you important information to everyday life. Founded in the late 50s, Crawford Broadcasting is currently bringing the gospel to 22 radio stations from Southern California to Rochester, New York. We would be honored to have you become a listener of our exceptional, hopeful programming by tuning in to AM 740 or going online to kbrightradio.com.
Are you ready for Vacation Bible School? We are, and it's coming right to your home. Kids love heroes, and this summer, instead of talking about the superheroes from the movies, we will learn about Bible heroes. Miriam, Samuel, and Rhoda were all kids that did little things that made a big difference. Each day, we'll talk about different characteristics of real heroes and how Jesus is with us and will help us be heroes by doing little things that will make a big difference. Kids will learn to be brave for Jesus, be devoted to Jesus, be caring to others, be bold in sharing, and be generous to others. The entire program will be available for you to do while you are safe at home. Begin each day at Bethany, where kids sing great songs. Learn the daily action point.
Be generous. Jesus is with me.
And Bible verse. And the Bible hero for the day is introduced. Then we head on out to explore the town. At Discovery House, they will hear the Bible story told by our great team of puppeteers. Next, it's off to the arena, where we will learn about a different animal each day. A favorite stop is always the Oasis Prayer Station, where kids will learn how much Jesus loves them, do an activity, and spend time in prayer. Your kids will love the fun and interactive learning at our Heroes Home Edition Vacation Bible School. Don't miss it. Sign up today.